Election was the historic election of 1892. I'm sure all of you remember it from your history books. That election was only memorable for two reasons. One, Grover Cleveland was elected to his non-consecutive term, being the only president to have non-consecutive terms. And the key issue in that race was that of sound and currency. I guess that some things are simply never going to change. As we look forward, another 120 years may pass, and it's simply presumptuous to assume how this election cycle will be remembered. But it is not presumptuous to assume one thing, and that is, due to the effort of those putting this event together and all of you who came out tonight, I am quite certain that tonight will go down in the history of Concordia College as one of its truly outstanding nights. And for that, I thank you. And now I think it's time to introduce our moderator and give this show on the road. I would like to welcome the President and CEO of Freedom Force Communications, the host of the Scott Cannon Radio Show, and the author of Grassroots. And most important to tonight's occasion, through bold active word, he is a sincere supporter and friend of Concordia College. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Scott Cannon.
Thanks very much, Tyler. It's wonderful to be among such great, just enthusiastic kids at a great institution. And he's right, I am a proud supporter of Concordia College. Many dear friends are along here and have come to just really thoroughly enjoy it, to the point now they call me a born-again copper. So whenever I sign anything, it's BAC, that means born-again copper. So, and Dr. Creech, Tyler, thank you for the warm introduction to all my friends at Concordia. And I think John Pierce coined that born-again copper phrase, and he's, of course, a great part of the development office here. Teresa's over there, and Dr. Kant at the Ron Offit School of Business, and so many folks here that I appreciate so very much. As someone who grew up in the family business and has been working part-time since I was 12, full-time since I was a freshman in high school, work about triple time since I graduated high school, I didn't have the luxury of higher education that many of you today have had. And so if I get anywhere within the same zip code of the intellectual capacity of Concordia, I love the fact that I can call myself among you here in Carville. I also want to take a moment to thank some very special guests who were kind enough to accept my invitation and come today for the event. They include the namesake of the new Ron Offit School of Business, fabulous Concordia alum, Ron Offit, the Sultan of Spuds, as I talk about in the book, and of course, among the most distinguished alumnus of this great institution, who was gracious enough to be here tonight, along with America's most successful oil man, America's oil champion, Harold Hamm. So please give these gentlemen a vote. Thank you for being here. Both, by the way, in their American story and their investment have a lot within their purview and their companies and their investment that could fix America, without question. And hopefully I'll get a chance to nudge James about that. Maybe he can take it back a few ideas to some of his political cohorts to learn from American ingenuity and what it could do to once again revive our economy. I certainly look forward to being able to have that discussion tonight as well. You all have maybe heard a little bit about this book, Grassroots, that I'm going to talk about just a moment before I introduce James and Mary for our wonderful evening here tonight at Concordia. But I also want to thank some of the sponsors who have made this possible. Anybody, when they arrived, see a certificate on their chair for a free book? Raise your hand. All right, 100 of you. Thank Annabelle Holmes. Annabelle Holmes, and if you need a place to live in the oil patch, North Dakota, which is the Wild West, remember that name, Annabelle Holmes. Give them a hand. They brought the questions for us tonight. Great company, some great entrepreneurial instincts from Dean DeVallis and his team of folks that are just absolutely, you know, you need those instincts, as my friend Harold will attest to. That's what gets so many things going on, and it's stepping up and building homes in Stanley and Tioga and Columbus and everywhere else. Also, another good friend, Michael Chambers and Al Devron, gave our distinguished guests an opportunity to receive a copy of the book Grassroots, so thank you, Michael Chambers and Al Devron, wherever you are, Michael. Appreciate that very much. By the way, if you have one of those certificates afterwards out there in the lobby, just go to that door and straight back. We'll be signing copies. Happy to personalize them for you as well, so come on by. If you were not lucky enough, speaking of capitalism, to get one of those free books. I'll sell you one tonight and put your name on it. Your grandma's name on it, your grandpa's name on it, your dog's name, it doesn't matter. In fact, I've given Harold one already, so I inscribed his to his dog, to Cole. So Cole's got a book now. Anyway, one of the great honors of my life has been to write this book, Grassroots. It really has. My wife Maria's in the front row here and already mortified that I introduced her once tonight. Won't do it again for the benefit of the crowd. Encouraged me to do this. I said, I'm not an author. I'm a radio talk show. This makes no sense. Mary Madeline, who you meet a little bit, is the editor-in-chief of Threshold, and she encouraged me to do it. They put me in touch with a gentleman by the name of Jim Denny, whose name is also on the front cover, co-authored books with Michael Reagan and others. By the time we put together, he'd done a little research on me and the show, and he said, we got there on the phone one day, he said, Scott, I've calculated that you write on average one book a week. I said, what are you talking about? He said, you just say it, which means I'm a blacker mouth, and that's what it means. But the point is, what we did with this book is just take some of the things I talk about, some of the things I'm passionate about from the radio show, and repurpose them for the book. That gets you part of the way down the road. And then, of course, you start thinking about some themes and where you want to go. And the Tea Party movement was exploding at the time. And I saw really what I saw as, you know, aunts and uncles of mine and Maria's, you know, family members, you know, that kind of salt of the earth, wonderful people who were just very concerned about the direction this country is going. And so I got to do something about it. And rolled up their sleeves, not as Republicans, not as Democrats, not as independents, as people concerned about the direction of this country, and said, I have to do something. And whether it was make a sign that said, drill, baby, drill, and I did, Harold, whether it was to say, you know, the Holocaust of abortion is wrong, whether it is to say, hey, get your hands off my money, or little kids with piggy banks, whatever, everybody expressed it in a different way. And it was extraordinary. It was not about just one thing. A lot of people think the Tea Party movement is about, for instance, our debt and deficit. I always say that was the match that lit the fire, no question about it. When you saw the spending, you saw what was happening to the debt, you see a president, a administration, now get your minds around this for a second, that doubled our national debt. This administration proposed what will double our debt. One presidency, all the other previous presidents combined. That's a scary thought. I call it on the radio program, fiscal child abuse. Generational theft. It's robbing from our kids and grandkids. And I couldn't stand up for it. And I saw people who were telling the story and were out there just trying to do something about it. I said, I gotta speak for them. They're being maligned. And whatever the issue, I mean, as I mentioned, the pro-life issue is important there. Energy is important there. We talk about that. You know, so there are many things in the book, and I really did a very important thing by trying to help give their message a little more voice in other areas besides just the ones that you hear about. And of course, how are they blind? You know, how are they? And part of the thing that inspires me, what do we have to offer here in this part of the world? Lowest unemployment, fastest job growth, a surplus, in the case of North Dakota, sorry, Minnesota. You got L. Franken-like mentality still over there. You got a ways to go. But in North Dakota, everything that ails this country and what ultimately could help revive American economy. All of it integral to this book and to the Tea Party movement, and I just try to tell a few of those stories. So, some of the folks who are in the audience, maybe they'll get a chance to ask questions later. My friend Linda Coates and I have started a series with the help of the Fargo Forum. Bill and Jane Marcille were introduced earlier, two dear people and wonderful benefactors to this school as well. And their son, Bill Marcille Jr., is now published with the Fargo Forum. And he and I were at lunch one day, he's a good friend, we're talking about some different ideas, and he said, why don't you do a point-counterpoint thing? He said, sign me up, let's go. And Linda Coates was a willing partner, and so now, well, regularly in the forum, we're doing this point-counterpoint thing. But Linda and I have always been different politically. Linda Stanley, would you give